In my previous report, I gave you a complete rundown on the New Testament, where it came from. And remember, if you want to go into the internet at the moment, you can get $4 million if you can come up with one historical shred of evidence that a person called Jesus walked the streets of Jerusalem as a person. Do you know that all of the court cases that were ever held in the Roman Empire, you can get copies of the transcript? Well, guess what? Try as much as you like. There's no record of ever being a court case where a fellow called Yeshua or Jesus Christ was held and subsequently crucified on a place called Golgotha. As a matter of fact, when I was over at Jerusalem, I can tell you, there's actually three places, but there's two main places that lay claim that this is where Jesus' tomb is, or this is where Golgotha, this is where the crucifixion took place. It's a big money-making scheme for the Catholic Church. So you will not find, no matter how hard you try, you will not find any authenticate details of manuscript or papers of any description of any historical origin that there was ever a fellow called Jesus walked this earth. And it's proof positive that there is no record, absolutely no record whatsoever. And you know what, if you go looking for it and you ask the Catholic Church for a copy of the early manuscripts, they won't give it to you. They won't give it to you because they know damn well. If they give you anything, it's going to disclose that their fellow Eusebius put the whole hoax together. There are some terrible atrocities, some shocking, horrific, lying, fraudulent acts. I put in this video report a little bit about the 9/11 being a false flag situation where the Bush administration killed 3,000 of their own people. Why? Because they want to set up new laws, emergency laws, put everybody under a complete worldwide war on terrorism. War on terrorism so they can lock people up just because you didn't do the right thing or you didn't agree with them. And this is going to be the beginning of the terrible time of trouble such as never was before. And we're going to be under the Noahide laws, as I said before. And you can see that with this little clip on Maimonides. Back at the time that the translation of the New Testament was being put together, as you will recall, the Jews will not utter the name Yahweh, the sacred name. So all through it, you have the word Adon or Adonai. Let me give you some rundown on Adonis. Adonis, whose name in Hebrew means Lord, L-O-R-D, or Master, was born to a virgin on the 25th of December. Adonis was also called the Anointed One, and Adonis suffered for mankind. Before his death and subsequent resurrection at the time of the spring equinox, which is Easter, the festival of the resurrection of Adonis was observed in Alexandria for millennia, and it was the cradle of Christianity. In the time of Pope Zosimus, the festival also was observed at Antioch, the ancient capital of Syria, where the followers of pagan deities had now transferred their worship to the new name of Yeshua, Jesus, in the time of Pope Liberius. Now, the celebration in honor of the resurrection of Adonis, a pagan festival, the festival ceremonies held in the Catholic countries on Good Friday and Easter Sunday are nothing more than the same festival of the death and resurrection of Adonis. The children of Israel had forsaken Yahweh for the same pagan god, Tammuz. Now, That's, I read that to you whilst there's a picture of myself standing there with David. That's a typical scene when we were standing at the Wailing Wall in Jerusalem. Now, the latest development concerning the name Yahweh, and this is only posted on the internet a week ago. It says, there will be no name Yahweh in any songs, prayers of the Catholic masses the Vatican has made a ruling. In Washington, CNS records, in the not too distant future, songs such as You Are Near, I Will Bless Yahweh, and Rise, O Yahweh, will no longer be part of the Catholic worship experience in the United States. This is spreading over to the Christian churches where they will no longer speak or worship the name Yahweh. In other words, Satan's putting a stranglehold on making sure that you worship him as the idol Jesus. At the very least, it says the songs will be edited to remove the word Yahweh. The name of God that the Vatican has ruled must not be used or pronounced in songs or prayers. And don't forget, this is exactly what the Talmudic Jews have also said. And in the Noahide laws of the Talmudic Jews, they will behead a person that uses the name Yahweh. So the stranglehold is getting tighter and tighter against the people that would just worship the Almighty Creator God Yahweh. That's a picture of myself with David at the Wailing Wall in Jerusalem. Now I'll continue on. In the pagan deities, under a decree from the kings, they were to be assassinated. And of course Christ, under a decree, was to be assassinated. The pagan gods were without sin, and of course Christ was claimed to be without sin. And the pagan gods always celebrated that Last Supper, as I said before, with the worship of Jeroboam, and the Easter celebration, which was worshipped 2,000 years BC, they always celebrated the so-called Last Supper, and of course Christ was seen as taking the position of the Last Supper with his disciples. The pagan deities forgave their enemies, and of course Christ forgave the enemies. The pagan gods were called the Saviour of mankind, and so was the Christ. He was called the Saviour of mankind. You know, I mentioned Maimonides, I mentioned Hillel, Gamaliel. These fellows are mentioned in the New Testament, but these fellows are Jewish sages that were carrying over the counterfeit Baal worship. And that's easy to prove because of the story that is now in the New Testament Bible. I have another little bit of news for you, and the picture that you're looking at on the screen is a picture that I took of the south part of the wall of Jerusalem, which was destroyed back in 70 AD. Now this little bit of news that I'm going to give you, these pagan deities, and I will mention Romulus, Remus, Perseus, Krishna, Zeus, and Oedipus. All of these had something in common which was transferred over to the Jesus idol, and that is that they were, when they were babies, that they were going to be slain by the king because they were going to usurp the throne. And the stories also are of a child that was born as a son of God to a virgin. So that is part of the pagan teachings for a couple of thousand years BC. Now the picture on your screen at the moment is typical of the reliefs and the items that depict Zeus or Apollo or Jupiter, which is now present day Mary and present day Jesus. And as you can see, the reliefs of Inanna, the Queen of Heavens, which is Mary today, and Ishtar, Ashtar, and Tammuz, that was the pagan worship deities way back with the children of Israel. Now let me just give you another point. Don't forget that there's a lot of Eastern Europe countries who thought that their God Jesus was born on the 6th of January. This is particular in Armenian countries. Now that is because in the ancient deities, that was one area that they believed in. It says that we know in Roman times the gods Tammuz, Aeon, and Osiris were identified. Osiris and Aeon were said to be born of the virgin Isis on the 6th of January. And this explains the earlier date for what was held as Christmas by the European people. And there are still people in Europe that keep the 6th of January as their Christmas. You've got to remember that in the previous clip also I showed you that the Khazars, K-H-A-Z-A-R, the Khazars, they are people that kicked off what you now have as Lubavitch or Hasidic Judaism. They're the fellas running around in the black hats and the black capes. And they came from a place called Khazaria, which is near Georgia, Chechnya in Russia. Now, these people had nothing to do with the Jews of Abraham, Isaac and Jacob. And what they wrote, the Talmud, that is what they go by before they will go by the Torah. And as you know, Yahweh God made it very, very clear. Do not add to my words, he said. Do not add to my words. And you've got these people that come from up there in Russia who tell the world that they got the Talmud from Moses as the oral law. The oral law, which is what they go by. And I can tell you, we showed you, that is the synagogue of Satan. No doubt about that. So these deceptions that came through BC, AD, and now, with the evidence that I've shown you on this video report, you can quite easily see that the deception of Jesus is the greatest hoax. You've got theologians running around the world looking for the Antichrist. Well, that's Christ. That's Satan himself, set up as Christ, right under their noses. And you've got diehard Christian people who just won't accept the fact that it's a hoax, that Jesus is a fraud. And they will make excuses to say, oh no, Jesus is the real one, all of the other are the counterfeit. And as I said before in this report, you can't have a copy or a counterfeit until after there was a real one. And the real ones were the pagan deities. Jesus is the counterfeit. He's the counterfeit God, set up right in front of people's noses, and they worship a fella called Jesus, which is the greatest fraud ever. And I just hope and pray that the evidence that I've shown you here on this video report, you'll really realize and just say sorry to Yahweh and seek Yahweh in prayer for forgiveness. On your screen now, that's actually a picture that I took of the gates that you walk through to go into the Wailing Wall on the western side of Jerusalem. Now there's another little note here that I'll share with you. And this you can get in the history books. And by the way, this was also published in secular newspapers. Jesus and the pagan god Dionysus. Like Dionysus, the infant Jesus was wrapped in swaddling clothes and placed in a manger. Like Dionysus, Jesus could turn the water into wine. Like Dionysus, Jesus rode on an ass and fed the multitude in the wilderness. Like Dionysus, Jesus suffered and was mocked. And many early Christians claimed that Jesus had in fact been born, not in a stable, but in a cave, just like Dionysus. I remember that the Passover occurred at the time of the vernal equinox. It's an event considered important by astrologers during the Roman Empire. The astrologers thought of this time as the time of the crossing of the two astrological celestial circles, and this event was symbolized by a cross. Now, we're going to show you a clip later on here that Zeitgeist put together, and it's very informative on this particular issue. The idea that a special star had heralded the birth of Jesus and that a solar eclipse occurred at his death is typical of Tarsian astrological superstition. The third factor contributing to the crucifixion story is again pagan mythology. The theme of a divine or semi-divine being sacrificed against a tree, pole or cross and then being resurrected is very common in many pagan mythology. And it was found in the mythologies of all Western civilizations stretching from as far west as Ireland and as far east as India. And in particular, it is found in the mythologies of Osiris and Attis, both of whom were often identified with Tammuz. And Osiris landed up with his arms stretched out on a tree like Jesus on the cross. And this is what is represented in the story of Jesus today. Now that's a picture I took of Nazareth. So if you want to know what Nazareth looks like today, there it is. And I read this report to you. The Romans never used a traditional so-called Christian cross for crucifixions. They always used one like a cross or like a T. And the hieroglyph of a cross on the hill was associated with Osiris. And this hieroglyph stood for the good one. In Greek, it mentioned Christos, a name that was applied to Osiris and other pagan gods. And I might also repeat with you, there was never, ever, ever any agreement with the Roman Empire that the Jews would hand up or give over or pull a guilty felon and give him freedom at Passover. That is an outright lie. It has never happened, and there was never ever two, like Caiaphas and Annas, two high priests, never in the history of Israel. More on the Christian story, and whilst I read it to you, that's a typical scene that I took driving along in the car in the streets of Nazareth. I might say to you here, at the vernal equinox, pagans in northern Israel would celebrate the death and resurrection of the virgin-born Tammuz, or Osiris. In Asia Minor, where the earliest Christian churches were established, a similar celebration was held for the virgin-born Attis. And Attis was shown as a dying against a tree, being buried in a cave and then being resurrected on the third day. So we now see another peg in the story of the mythical Jesus. On your screen now, you have a picture that I took of the people down on the water at the Dead Sea. And of course, there's the showers that the public have. And I'll read this in a report to you. The pagans believe that when their nature god, such as Tammuz, Osiris, or Attis, died and was resurrected, his life went into plants that man used as food. This is why you've got the wafer that they eat, and that is eating the body of their god, like the body of Christ today, or they were eating it as the body of Osiris or Attis or Tammuz back in the pagan years. Now the matzah that is made from the spring harvest was his new body, and of course the wine from the grapes was his new blood. In Judaism though, the matzah was not used to represent the body of a god, but the poor man's bread which the Jews ate before leaving Egypt in a hurry. And the pagans also eat eggs to represent the resurrection and the rebirth of their nature god. But the egg on the Seder plate for the Jews represents the rebirth of the Jewish people when they were escaping from Egypt. Now, here you have an example of why we have Easter eggs at Easter, for the pagans did that thousands of years BC, and Christians are still doing it every Easter day today. Now when you go up to Acre or Haifa, there's a typical scene of a picture I took of the Arab fishing boats coming in. And here's a bit more report for you. The historical Pontius Pilate was an arrogant despot. He hated the Jews, and he never delegated any authority to them whatsoever. And what you read in the New Testament is an outright lie. In the Christian mythology, he is portrayed as a concerned ruler who distanced himself from the accusations against Jesus and who was coerced into obeying the demands of the Jews. That is a lie. And according to Christian mythology, every Passover that the Jews would ask Pilate to free a criminal, that is an absolute lie, as I said before. Now, the Jews never, ever freed any criminal. Never, ever. And according to the myth, of course, Pilate gave the Jews the choice of freeing either the Christ or Barabbas. Again, that is an absolute lie. You often read in the Bible the account of the people that lived at Acre. Well, that is typical of what the people walked around at Acre. And here's another scene where you can see that the ruins are well preserved And that's exactly what it would have been like 2,000-3,000 years ago. Attributes for the pagan gods and of the Christ. And as a matter of fact, most of this was printed and published in both the Queensland papers and the Sydney Morning Herald. This is pretty common knowledge, and I'll read it to you. But up the top it says that both deities of mythical gods, talking about, say, Krishna, Horus, Addis, Adonis, Dionysus, they have historical evidence that they were real beings. No, there's no historical evidence that they were real beings. They were not. They were mythical beings. There's only religious records of their existence that are written by devotees of each particular faith. The Christian Church has gone to extreme lengths to prop up their beliefs and to suppress the clear evidence of how the pagan deities and their attributes were just transferred over to a new mythical deity called Jesus and Mary. But as I said, most of this was actually published in the secular newspapers. And on the left-hand side, you have the pagan deities, such as Krishna. And it says, item one, referred to as both God and the Son of God. On the right, you have the column for Christ, where he was referred to as both God and the Son of God. On the left, the pagan deity, considered human and divine. On the right, Christ was considered human and divine. Now, there's always an argument that Christians will put up about Christ is the real and the others are the counterfeit. No, I'm sorry, that's impossible. If you want to talk about counterfeit and copies, if you've got a $20 note, the original $20 note comes up first, and then those make copies of it, that's your counterfeit. And Christ came up 2,000 years after these particular pagan gods were well established in society. Now, I'll read this to you as I go through some of the pictures that I took at Jerusalem. In the pagan deities, they were always referred to as the second person of the Trinity, and of course Christ was referred to as the second person of the Trinity. The pagan god Adonis and the pagan god of Krishnas, they were baptized in the river Ganges, and of course Christ was baptized in the river Jordan. They all died, were buried, resurrected 3 days later. The pagan deities are referred to as the Shepherd of God, and of Christ, he was referred to as the Shepherd of God. The pagan deities were referred to as the Lord of Lords, the Redeemer, and Christ was referred to as the Lord of Lords, the Redeemer. As we showed you before, and I'll bring the clip up again later, the wise men and the shepherds were guided by a star to the birth of all of the deities, and that was happening 2,000-3,000 BC. And of course, in the story of Christ, the wise men and the shepherds were guided by a star to his birth. So this is just a good example to show you and to prove that the attributes of all of the pagan deities, and it doesn't matter whether you go to the Grecian one, the Roman one, the Mesopotamia, the Babylonian one, they were all sun god worshipping systems. And the Baal worship of sun god, the today's Mary and Jesus, that is the same as the Ishtar, Ashtar and Tammuz 2000 BC. That is the same as the children of Israel who were worshipping the counterfeit, what we call today Easter. That was a counterfeit Passover, or a counterfeit Pesach, and they've been doing that thousands of years BC. How many times do we have to show this to people? It's published in newspapers. How many times do they have to read it and realize that anything to do with Christianity is a hoax, and it is a counterfeit copy of all of the pagan deities? While I read the rest of these pagan deities' attributes, that's a picture that I took of the southern wall of Jerusalem. Now I'm going to item three. Pagan gods claim they are the resurrection. Christ claimed, I am the resurrection. The pagan gods were called the Lion of the Tribe, and of course Christ was maintained as the Lion of the Tribe. The pagan gods were considered omniscient and omnipotent. And of course, the Christ was considered omniscient and omnipotent. The pagan gods provided and performed miracles, healing of diseases, and so of course the Christ performed miracles and healing of diseases. The pagan god Krishna, Adonis and Dionysus healed the leprosy, and of course Christ is accused of healing a leper. You recall in the Daniel prophecy, Nebuchadnezzar's dream, and it says in the good book, the words, and I'll read to you, talk about Yahweh has informed you, King Nebuchadnezzar, what will be at the end of days. In another Bible says, what will be in the last days. So this particular prophecy is about today. It's not about 538 BC, although it's explaining which culture, religious culture, there is. It says, you, Nebuchadnezzar, you're the head of gold. That's the Babylon Empire. Then the Medo-Persian Empire comes up with a chest of silver. Then you've got the thighs of brass or copper, which represent the Grecian Empire. Then you've got the Roman Empire. Now, the most important part of this prophecy is down there where it says, and I'll read the words to you. As you watched, the stone was cut out of the mountains without hands, and it struck the statue on its feet of iron and clay, and it crumbled them and the image. Then they, the whole image, crumbled together, the iron, the clay, the copper, the silver, the gold. They became like chaff from the summer threshing floor, and the winds carried them away, and no trace was found of them. And the stone that struck the statue became a great mountain and filled the entire earth. So realize what it just said to you. The stone here that hit this whole image, so it says the gold, the silver, the thighs of brass, the legs of iron, the entire image was destroyed in one event, not conquered by Medo-Persia, conquered Babylon, and then the Grecian Empire conquered the Medo. No, it is talking about religious kingdoms. Remember that, because it says about all of these religions and religious kingdoms, it says quite clearly that there will be no trace found of them because they are all destroyed ultimately by the hand of Yahweh. And this does not represent Jesus Christ here. This represents the hand of Yahweh. Yahweh, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Yahweh brings in his kingdom. And again in Daniel chapter 7 and Daniel chapter 8, it is repeated that he brings in his kingdom and gives it to the saints. You will recall in Daniel 7, there's a lion, a bear, and a leopard, followed by a terrible beast with 10 horns, then a little horned power. Now just briefly again, to recap what we gave you in that report, the lion has eagle's wings. That represents Great Britain and the coalition with USA. The bear represents Russia, and as we made a point before, it would appear that that it's France, Germany, and China, the three ribs in its mouth. Not quite sure about that. But then you've got the leopard, the leopard with four heads, four divisions, four wings. And again, it's quite clear now that is the New World Order, because they've divided the world up into four divisions with four heads. The traditional understanding is that was Alexander the Great, 321 BC, but it's not. Again, the reason why we know that the church's traditional interpretation of these prophecies is grossly incorrect, because this terrible beast down here with the ten horns and the little horn power, I'm going to read to you what it says in the good book about it. Now, let me read this to you. Daniel in these deliberations says, I saw that after this, because of the sound of the haughty words which the little horn spoke, and then I watched until the beast was slain and its body destroyed and consigned to the eternal flame. So this whole thing was destroyed by the hand of God, destroyed by the eternal flame. But as for the rest of the beasts, these other three, it says, their dominion was taken away, yet their lives were extended again for a season and a time. So Babylon wasn't wiped out. Greece wasn't wiped out. It clearly says that these other three animals, beasts, they remained alive for a season and a time. Their dominion was taken away, but they remained alive for a season and a time. So it is nothing to do with Babylon being conquered by Medo-Persia, that was conquered by Grecian Empire and so on. Nothing to do with that at all. And that terrible beast down the bottom there is none other than the New World Order. There is a time of trouble such as never was before that's going to hit mankind. And it is so devastating, it is so terrible, the destruction is so horrible that it is only by the hand of Yahweh to put a stop to it. And Yahweh does put a stop to it, and again it makes it clear that judgment was set and the dominion and the powers was given over to the holy people, and the holy people received the kingdom of God, the kingdom of Yahweh forever and ever, an eternal kingdom. This terrible beast in Daniel 7, there is no doubt that that now has emerged as being the new world order. But it is slain. It is burnt up by the hand of Yahweh God. So when the terrible beast is slain and its body given over to the eternal flame of destruction, it does say quite clearly, then that is when judgment was set, the books were open, and the saints of God received the kingdom of Yahweh. Exactly the same as it said in Daniel 2 and again in Daniel 8. You can go all the way back to King David's time. You can go back 1000 BC. It's not long after, and by the way, that picture on your screen is a picture I took of King David's Tower. It's still there, and that's what it looked like 1,000 years BC, and there it is again for you to see on your screen right now. But realize, after King David, then his son Solomon took over. But then Solomon went off the rails and worshipped the idol god of what you've got today as Easter. And then, of course, Rehoboam took over the two tribes in Jerusalem. The other 10 tribes seceded up to Shechem. And eventually that brought in the total destruction of God's people right through today to what you've got in the way of the counterfeit worship system. And that is Jesus and Mary carried over from way back here, 400 years after King David's Tower there. It won't matter which of the old Christian churches you see in Europe today, this image of Zeus or Odin or Woden or Dionysus, whoever you want to call him, they were there as the deities that they were being worshipped 2,000 years BC. And of course now, that fellow you look at out on the screen has given a new name called Jesus. Now, there's lots of reports on the internet about who Jesus was or if he ever existed and how his being was transferred over from the pagan deities to 3000 BC. And this is one from Zeitgeist Film. And if you can get the full copy of the Zeitgeist Film, you'll find it very, very informative.
As far back as 10,000 BC. History is abundant with carvings and writings reflecting people's respect and adoration for this object. And it is simple to understand why, as every morning the sun would rise, bringing vision, warmth, and security, saving man from the cold, blind, predator-filled darkness of night. Without it, the cultures understood, the crops would not grow, and life on the planet would not survive. These realities made the sun the most adored object of all time. Likewise, they were also very aware of the stars. The tracking of the stars allowed them to recognize and anticipate events which occurred over long periods of time, such as eclipses and full moons. They in turn catalog celestial groups into what we know today as constellations. This is the cross of the zodiac, one of the oldest conceptual images in human history. It reflects the sun as it figuratively passes through the 12 major constellations over the course of a year. It also reflects the 12 months of the year, the four seasons, and the solstices and equinoxes. The term zodiac relates to the fact that constellations were anthropomorphized, or personified, as figures or animals. In other words, the early civilizations did not just follow the sun and stars, they personified them with elaborate myths involving their movements and relationships. The sun, with its life-giving and saving qualities, was personified as a representative of the unseen creator or God, God's sun, the light of the world, the savior of humankind. Likewise, the 12 constellations represented places of travel for God's sun, and were identified by names usually representing elements of nature that happened during that period of time. For example, Aquarius, the water bearer, who brings the spring rains. This is Horus. He is the sun god of Egypt of around 3000 BC. He is the sun, anthropomorphized, and his life is a series of allegorical myths involving the sun's movement in the sky. From the ancient hieroglyphics in Egypt, we know much about the solar messiah. For instance, Horus, being the sun or the light, had an enemy known as Set, and Set was the personification of the darkness or night. And, metaphorically speaking, every morning Horus would win the battle against Set, while in the evening Set would conquer Horus and send him into the underworld. It is important to note that dark versus light, or good versus evil, is one of the most ubiquitous mythological dualities ever known, and is still expressed on many levels to this day. Broadly speaking, the story of Horus is as follows. Horus was born on December 25th of the Virgin Isis Mary. His birth was accompanied by a star in the east, and upon his birth he was adored by three kings. At the age of 12, he was a prodigal child teacher, and at the age of 30, he was baptized by a figure known as Anup, and thus began his ministry. Horus had 12 disciples he traveled about with, performing miracles such as healing the sick and walking on water. Horus was known by many gestural names such as the Truth, the Light, God's Anointed Son, the Good Shepherd, the Lamb of God, and many others. After being betrayed by Typhon, Horus was crucified, buried for 3 days, and thus resurrected. These attributes of Horus, whether original or not, seem to permeate many cultures of the world, for many other gods are found to have the same general mythological structure. Attis of Phrygia, born of the Virgin Nana on December 25th, crucified, placed in a tomb, and after 3 days was resurrected. Krishna of India, born of the Virgin Devaki, with a star in the east signaling his coming. He performed miracles with his disciples, and upon his death was resurrected. Dionysus of Greece, born of a virgin on December 25th, was a traveling teacher who performed miracles such as turning water into wine. He was referred to as the King of Kings, God's only begotten Son, the Alpha and Omega, and many others. And upon his death, he was resurrected. Mithra of Persia, born of a virgin on December 25th, he had 12 disciples and performed miracles, and upon his death was buried for 3 days and thus resurrected. He was also referred to as the Truth, the Light, and many others. Interestingly, the sacred day of worship of Mithra was Sunday. The fact of the matter is, there are numerous saviors from different periods from all over the world which subscribe to these general characteristics. The question remains, why these attributes? Why the virgin birth on December 25th? Why dead for 3 days in the inevitable resurrection? Why 12 disciples or followers? To find out, let's examine the most recent of the solar messiahs. Jesus Christ was born of the Virgin Mary on December 25th in Bethlehem. His birth was announced by a star in the east, which three kings or magi followed to locate and adorn a new savior. He was a child teacher at 12. At the age of 30, he was baptized by John the Baptist, and thus began his ministry. Jesus had 12 disciples, which he traveled about with, performing miracles, such as healing the sick, walking on water, raising the dead. He was also known as the King of Kings, the Son of God, the Light of the World, the Alpha and Omega, the Lamb of God, and many, many others. After being betrayed by his disciple Judas and sold for 30 pieces of silver, he was crucified, placed in a tomb, and after 3 days was resurrected and ascended into heaven. 1st of all, the birth sequence is completely astrological. The star in the east is Sirius, the brightest star in the night sky, which, on December 24th, aligns with the three brightest stars in Orion's belt. These three bright stars in Orion's belt are called today what they were called in ancient times, the Three Kings. And the Three Kings and the brightest star, Sirius, all point to the place of the sunrise on December 25th. This is why the Three Kings follow the star in the east, in order to locate the sunrise, the birth of the sun. The Virgin Mary is the constellation Virgo, also known as Virgo the Virgin. Virgo in Latin means virgin. Virgo is also referred to as the house of bread, and the representation of Virgo is a virgin holding a sheaf of wheat. This house of bread and its symbol of wheat represents August and September, the time of harvest. In turn, Bethlehem, in fact, literally translates to house of bread. Bethlehem is thus a reference to the constellation Virgo, a place in the sky, not on earth. There's another very interesting phenomenon that occurs around December 25th, or the winter solstice. From the summer solstice to the winter solstice, the days become shorter and colder. And from the perspective of the northern hemisphere, the sun appears to move south and get smaller and more scarce. The shortening of the days and the expiration of the crops when approaching the winter solstice symbolize the process of death to the ancients. It was the death of the sun. And by December 22nd, the sun's demise was fully realized. For the sun, having moved south continually for 6 months, makes it to its lowest point in the sky. Here a curious thing occurs. The sun stops moving south, at least perceivably, for 3 days. And during this 3-day pause, the sun resides in the vicinity of the Southern Cross, or Crux, constellation. And after this time, on December 25th, the sun moves 1 degree, this time north, foreshadowing longer days, warmth, and spring. And thus it was said, the sun died on the cross, was dead for 3 days, only to be resurrected or born again. This is why Jesus and numerous other sun gods share the crucifixion, 3-day death, and resurrection concept. It is the sun's transition period before it shifts its direction back into the northern hemisphere, bringing spring and thus salvation. However, they did not celebrate the resurrection of the sun until the spring equinox, or Easter. This is because at the spring equinox, the sun officially overpowers the evil darkness, as daytime thereafter becomes longer in duration than the night, and the revitalizing conditions of spring emerge. Now, probably the most obvious of all the astrological symbolism around Jesus regards the 12 disciples. They are simply the 12 constellations of the zodiac, which Jesus, being the sun, travels about with. In fact, the number 12 is replete throughout the Bible. Coming back to the cross of the zodiac, the figurative life of the sun, this was not just an artistic expression or tool to track the sun's movement. It was also a pagan spiritual symbol, the shorthand of which looked like this. This is not a symbol of Christianity. It is a pagan adaptation of the cross of the zodiac. This is why Jesus in early occult art is always shown with his head on the cross, for Jesus is the Son of God, the Light of the World, the risen Savior who will come again. As it does every morning, the glory of God, who defends against the works of darkness, as he is born again every morning. most important has to do with the ages. Throughout the scriptures, there are numerous references to the age. In order to understand this, we need to be familiar with a phenomenon known as the precession of the equinoxes. The ancient Egyptians, along with cultures long before them, recognized that approximately every 2150 years, the sunrise on the morning of the spring equinox would occur in a different sign of the zodiac. This has to do with a slow, angular wobble that the Earth maintains as it rotates on its axis. It is called a precession because the constellations go backwards rather than through the normal yearly cycle. The amount of time it takes for the precession to go through all 12 signs is roughly 25,765 years. This is also called the Great Year. And ancient societies were very aware of this, and they referred to each 2150-year period as an age. From 4300 BC to 2150 BC, it was the age of Taurus, the bull. From 2150 BC to 1 AD, it was the age of Aries, the ram. And from 1 AD to 2150 AD, it is the age of Pisces, the age we are still in to this day. And in and around 2150, we will enter the new age, the age of Aquarius. Now, the Bible reflects, broadly speaking, a symbolic movement through three ages while foreshadowing a fourth. In the Old Testament, when Moses comes down Mount Sinai with the ten... The reality is, the golden bull is Taurus, the bull, and Moses represents the new age of Aries, the ram. This is why Jews even today still blow the ram's horn. Moses represents the new age of Aries, and upon the new age, everyone must shed the old age. Now Jesus is the figure who ushers in the age following Aries, the age of Pisces, or the two fish. Fish symbolism is very abundant in the New Testament. Jesus feeds 5,000 people with bread and two fish. When he begins his ministry walking along Galilee, he befriends two fishermen who follow him. And I think we have all seen the Jesus fish on the back of people's cars. Little do they know what it actually means. It is a pagan astrological symbolism for the sun's kingdom during the age of Pisces. Also, Jesus' assumed birth date is essentially the start of this age. At Luke 22:10, when Jesus is asked by his disciples where the last Passover would be, Jesus replies, "Behold, when ye are entered into the city, there shall a man meet you, bearing a pitcher of water. Follow him into the house where he entereth in." This scripture is by far one of the most revealing of all the astrological references. The man bearing the pitcher of water is Aquarius, the water bearer, who is always pictured as a man pouring out a pitcher of water. He represents the age after Pisces, and when the sun, God's son, leaves the age of Pisces, Jesus, it will go into the house of Aquarius, as Aquarius follows Pisces in the procession of the equinoxes. All Jesus is saying is that after the age of Pisces will come the age of Aquarius. Now, we have all heard about the end times and the end of the world. The world is a misinterpreted Pisces, Jesus. It will go into the house of Aquarius, as Aquarius follows Pisces in the procession of the equinoxes. All Jesus is saying is that after the age of Pisces will come the age of Aquarius. Pre-Christian source than the Epic of Gilgamesh, written in 2600 BC. This story talks of a great flood commanded by God, an ark with saved animals upon it, and even the release and return of a dove, all held in common with the biblical story, among many other similarities. And then there is the plagiarized story of Moses, inscribed about 3,500 years ago on the walls at the Temple of Luxor in Egypt, are images of the Annunciation, the miracle conception, the birth, and the adoration of Horus. The images begin with Thoth announcing to the virgin Isis that she will conceive Horus, then Neph, the Holy Ghost, impregnating the virgin, and then the virgin birth and the adoration. This is exactly the story of Jesus' miracle conception. When we say that he, Jesus Christ, our teacher, was produced without sexual union, was crucified and died and rose again and ascended into heaven, we propound nothing different from what you believe regarding those who you esteem sons of Jupiter. In a different writing, Justin Martyr said, he was born of a virgin. Accept this in common with what you believe of Perseus. It's obvious that Justin and other early Christians knew how similar Christianity was to the pagan religions. Once the evidence is weighed, there are very high odds that the figure known as Jesus did not even exist.
Justice not based on truth. We find that Christianity was in fact nothing more than a Roman story developed politically.
The reality is, Jesus was the solar deity of the Gnostic Christian sect. And like all other pagan gods, he was a mythical figure. It was the political establishment that sought to historize the Jesus figure for social control. By 325 AD in Rome, Emperor Constantine convened the Council of Nicaea. It was during this meeting that the politically motivated Christian doctrines were established, and thus began a long history of Christian bloodshed and spiritual fraud. And for the
to raise the question of the truth of the sacred story, the keepers of the faith do not enter into debate with them. They ignore them or denounce them as blasphemers.
It is wrong, blasphemous, and sinful for you to suggest, imply, or help other people come to the conclusion that the U.S. government killed 3,000 of its own citizens.
Scenes of an old building being purposely dynamited and blown up.
Anybody who's ever watched a building being demolished on purpose knows that if you're going to do this, you have to get at the under infrastructure of a building and bring it down.
The way the structure is collapsing, this was the result of something that was planned. It's not accidental that the first tower just happened to collapse and then the second tower just happened to collapse in exactly the same way. How they accomplished this, we don't know.
The building collapsed to dust. You don't find a desk. You don't find a chair. You don't find a telephone, a computer. The biggest piece of a telephone I found was half of the keypad, and it was about this big.
What happened to the concrete?
The concrete was pulverized from river to river. There was dust powder, 2-3 inches thick. The concrete was just pulverized.
Premonition of those pictures we've all seen too much on television before, that a building was deliberately destroyed by well-placed dynamite to knock it down.
That's what they had detonated. Yes, detonated. They were planned to take down our building.
I heard a second explosion.
There was an heavy-duty explosion.
That was like several explosions and then the subsequent collapses.
An explosion blew and it knocked everybody over.
To me, it sounded like an explosion.
It sounded like gunfire.
Bang, 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 bang.
And then all of a sudden, three big explosions.
And we heard a big explosion coming down.
And then the entire top of the building just blew up.
We saw some kind of explosion.
By the force of the explosion.
Big explosion. Blew us back into the 8th floor.
Then we get to the lobby. It was a big explosion.
The lobby looked as though a bomb exploded there.
A huge explosion now raining debris.
It's been a huge explosion.
Huge explosion that we all heard and felt.
We just witnessed some kind of follow-up explosion.
In the words of George Tenet, that the warnings of an imminent attack were so severe that something dramatic should have been done. It was unparalleled. Instead, our president went on a month-long vacation.
Now, I could keep on going with a lot of information, but I think you've got to do your own research. Because what I've shown you is the evidence on the table now to make you realize there's a right and a wrong, a good and a bad. There's only two religions. One, you make a choice to worship Yahweh, the Creator God. Or two, worship any one of the others that you like. But they will not get you any answers from any prayers that you make. If you want to pray and you want to get an answer to your prayer, don't pray to Jesus, because the ears of Yahweh God are closed to any prayers through an idol. If you want to pray and you want to pray to Islam or Buddha or Hindu, any of the others, forget it. If you want to pray and get an answer, you pray to Yahweh. Because you know what? We're coming to a day, a time of trouble such as never was before. And there is absolutely no time left. I'm giving you this report in July, August. I believe by the end of September and October, we will have all hell break loose. I know we're headed for a global finance crash, and that's what will happen. And I think there will be anarchy. I believe in my heart that USA will crash. Well, I've just given you a lot of information about the Jesus myth, the hoax of Jesus, and how it was perpetrated up to 3,000 years BC. I've also given you enough supporting evidence from Zeitgeist films, how the pagan religions operated 2,000 and 3,000 years BC, and it explains to you what we ended up with in today's Easter, Mary and Jesus. Now, before I close, on this particular film report, I just want to give you a little bit about the 9/11 being a false flag, self-perpetrated USA Bush admin terrorism. The 9/11 was a well-planned demolishing of the Trade Center. As you will see by the witnesses on the street, as you will see by these ordinary on-the-street film clips. And you won't see these film clips again because the government control the media and the media have been gagged and they're not allowed to show it. But these are witnesses on the street showing you, showing the world, how they demolished these buildings and then they put the blame over onto a terrorist cell and a boogeyman up in Afghanistan called Osama bin Laden. By the way, they'll never find him. He's not supposed to be found. And this whole exercise, where they killed 3,000 people of their own, was to bring into Congress their acceptance for new draconian laws. And this is going to lead into the New World Order. And that's what they did. Now, there's already movements to impeach them between now and November, but that won't happen because there's not enough time frame for that process to take place. But I believe, and you will find on the internet now, those Bush administrative peoples who have been guilty of murder will be charged after they leave office, if they can catch them.
Intelligence of the ISI, Mahmoud Ahmed, requested Omar Sheikh to wire $100,000 to Mohammed Atta, who was the lead hijacker.
Did hijacker Mohammed Atta received wire transfers via Pakistan. The man sending the money to Atta is believed to be Ahmed Umar Saeed Sheikh.
Omar Sheikh admitted he was supported by the Pakistan government's intelligence service, the ISI.
Although we are told that four or five of the alleged hijackers were on each of the flights. If so, their names should have been on the flight manifests. But the flight manifests that have been released contain neither the names of the alleged hijackers nor any Arab names whatsoever.
We know that the men who were supposedly the hijackers had their houses, cars, credit cards paid for by the U.S. government. They were, in truth, agents.
Evidence was also apparently planted. The passport of one of the hijackers on Flight 11 was allegedly found in the rubble.
Goes through the fireball, through the side of the plane, and comes down to the ground unscathed. But something happened. For 6 months, they reported they had this passport.
Of course we're after Saddam Hussein, bin Laden. He's...
January 2001, the Bush administration orders the FBI and intelligence agencies to back off investigations involving the bin Laden family, including two of Osama bin Laden's relatives, who were living, guess where, in Falls Church, Virginia, right next to CIA headquarters.
When he was already America's most wanted criminal, he reportedly spent 2 weeks in the American hospital in Dubai, was treated by an American doctor, and visited by the local CIA agent.
We have not seen one piece of evidence that links Osama bin Laden directly to the planning stages of September 11th.
This failure to provide proof was later said to be unnecessary because bin Laden, in a video allegedly found in Afghanistan, admitted responsibility for the attacks. This confession is now widely cited as proof. But the man in this video has darker skin, fuller cheeks, and a broader nose than the Osama bin Laden of all other videos. We again seem to have planted evidence.
In 1976, Osama's older brother Salim bin Laden hired a man in Texas by the name of Jim Bath to handle all the investments in the United States for the bin Laden family. Jim Bath also happens to be a personal, almost lifelong friend and former Air National Guard pilot with George W. Bush. The connections between the Bushes and the bin Ladens become much more clear when George Herbert Walker Bush made trips to Saudi Arabia in 1998 and 2000 to meet with the bin Laden family on behalf of a company called the Carlyle Group.
125-foot-wide, 44-foot-tall plane through this obstacle course.
The aircraft, before striking the Pentagon, reportedly executed a 270-degree downward spiral. And yet, Hani Hanyur was known as a terrible pilot who could not safely fly even a small plane.
No seats, no luggage, no bodies. Nothing but bricks and limestone.
The official explanation is that the intense heat from the jet fuel vaporized the entire plane. Flight 77 had two Rolls-Royce engines made of steel and titanium alloy and weighed 6 tons each. It is scientifically impossible that 12 tons of steel and titanium was vaporized by jet fuel.
We're also told that the bodies were able to be identified either by their fingerprints or by the DNA. So what kind of fire can vaporize aluminum and tempered steel and yet leave human bodies intact?
From my close-up inspection, there's no evidence of a plane having crashed anywhere near the Pentagon. And as I said, the only pieces left that you can see are small enough that you could pick up in your hand.
Shortly after the strike, government agents picked up debris and carried it off. The entire lawn was covered with dirt and gravel, so that any remaining forensic evidence was literally covered up. Well, the videos from security cameras, which would show what really hit the Pentagon, were immediately confiscated by agents of the FBI, and the Department of Justice has to this day refused to release them. If these videos would prove that the Pentagon was really hit by a 757, most of us would assume the government would release them.